Praise is due to you, O God, you who answer prayer. Happy are those who live in your courts, those who are satisfied with the goodness of your house and your holy temple. You are the hope of all things, O Holy One, from the ends of the earth to the farthest seas. You make the gateways of the evening and the morning a shout for joy. Rejoice in God, O people, and be glad. Let us shout and sing together for joy. Now may the love of God, which is poured into our hearts, the saving grace of Jesus Christ, and the abundant life of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Let us pray. Holy God, our righteous judge, daily your mercy surprises us with everlasting forgiveness. Strengthen our hope in you and grant that all the peoples of the earth may find their glory in you through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading is from Jeremiah chapter 14. Although our iniquities testify against us, act, O Lord, for your name's sake. Our apostasies indeed are many, and we have sinned against you. O hope of Israel, its Savior in time of trouble, why should you be like a stranger in the land, like a traveler turning aside from the night? Why should you be like someone confused, like a mighty warrior who cannot give help? Yet you, O Lord, are in the midst of us, and we are called by your name. Do not forsake us. Thus says the Lord concerning this people, truly they have loved to wander. They have not restrained their feet. Therefore, the Lord does not accept them. Now he will remember their iniquity and punish their sins. Have you completely rejected Judah? Does your heart loathe Zion? Why have you struck us down so that there is no healing for us? We look for peace but find no good, for a time of healing but there is terror instead. We acknowledge our wickedness, O God, the iniquity of our ancestors, for we have sinned against you. Do not spurn us for your name's sake. Do not dishonor your glorious throne. Remember and do not break your covenant with us. Can any idols of the nations bring rain, or can the heavens give showers? Is it not you, O Lord our God? We set our hope on you, for it is you who do all this. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. O Prince of Peace, from peace that is no peace, from the grip of all that is evil, from an arrogant righteousness, deliver us. From the paralysis of will, from lies and misnaming, from terror and truth, deliver us. From hardness of heart, from watching passively as the world burns, from the worship of death, deliver us. By the hope of your gospel, by your choosing our flesh, by your nakedness and pain, heal us. By your weeping over the city, by your refusal of the sword, by your facing of horror, heal us. By your bursting from the tomb, by your coming in judgment, by your longing for peace, heal us. Grant us peace. Amen. Now may the peace of Christ, which has been revealed to the world, be with you always.
This is my song. This is my savior.
Our psalm for today is taken from Psalm 84. How dear to me is your dwelling, O Lord of hosts! My soul has a desire and longing for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest where she may lay her young, by the side of your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Happy are they who dwell in your house. They will always be praising you. Happy are the people whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on the pilgrim's way. Those who go through the balsam valley will find it a place of springs, for the early rains have covered it with pools of water. They will climb from height to height, and the God of gods will be seen in Zion. And our second reading is from 2 Timothy chapter 4. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. At my first defense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel for today is taken from St. Luke, the 18th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves, that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying thus, God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give a tenth of all my income. But the tax collector, standing far off, would not even look up to heaven, but was beating his breast and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified, rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let us pray. O Lord, let the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I will tell you a pet peeve of mine. We often look at hardships in our lives and we wonder where those come from. We might come to many different answers, but the one that bothers me is when someone looks around at the events in other communities and other parts of the world and realizes that their life could be so much worse. This bothers me for a couple of reasons. One is that it has the effect of pushing our pain away. If we believe that our pain could be worse, then we tacitly imply we should not complain or lament our suffering. We may not wish to linger in our pain, but there is a place for acknowledging and understanding that it is impacting our lives. To act as if it is not important is to act as if our sufferings, whatever they may be, are unimportant, and that is simply not true. But second, and maybe the more disturbing implication of this idea, is that we can stand comforted by the fact that we are not like those other people. We may be finding it hard to put food on the table due to inflation, but at least we are not like those who live in parts of the world where there is no food. We may have challenging moments with our kids or grandkids, but at least they are not on the streets, doing drugs and slowly killing themselves. We seem to take comfort in the fact that we are not like them. Our children are safe. There's food in the fridge. We are not like those others. That is exactly how the Pharisee views himself. Nothing he says about his own personal actions is wrong. Likely he does fast twice a week and give a tenth of all his income. He was a Pharisee after all. They valued good works as marks of their faith and devotion to God. But where he falls is in his opening statement. God, I thank you that I am not like the other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. His issue is not that he does what he does, it is the fact that he lords that over other people. Rather than just giving God thanks, he must place himself over and against the people he considers less than himself. And as Jesus points out, it is the tax collector in his penitence that comes to God with an open and true heart. It is the tax collector who throws himself on the mercy of God. So where do we fall? Are we like the Pharisee, believing ourselves blessed because we are not like those others who suffer? Or are we like the tax collector, willing to look into our own hearts and see the ways in which we have fallen short of God's call in our life and our call to serve those around us? Are we willing to be open to God and loving to our neighbors? Or are we more willing to shut the door on those who we consider beneath us and give thanks we are not like them? Our society is built to favor the latter. If you don't have the right house or the right car or the right clothes or enough money, then you have done something wrong. You aren't worthy of attention. If you aren't beautiful enough or athletic enough or tall enough or thin enough, you are a loser. We've always sought ways to be like the Pharisee, to hold ourselves over and against the other. Even as a church, we do that. In this community, we look around and see that other churches are larger and have more going on than we do, and we immediately wonder what we did wrong and how we are lesser than those other churches. The Pharisee in this text is our stand-in. Too often, we act too little like the tax collector who falls before God and in all openness and sincerity, and admits to needing God's grace, and who never chooses to compare himself to another. We act like the Pharisee, glad we are not like those others, glad somehow that we are better, glad we are not like them. And yet, that act of comparison flies in the face of everything that Scripture is about. We are never asked to hold ourselves over and against another. We are asked, as the tax collector does in this text, to come before God and give ourselves over to a good and gracious God. Psalm 51, though not one of our readings for today, is often used as a prayer of confession during Ash Wednesday and the period of Lent. In the psalmist's words, we hear the message that is exemplified through the actions of the tax collector. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone have I sinned and done in what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being, therefore teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness, that the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me in a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from bloodshed, O God, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your deliverance. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you have no delight in sacrifice. If I were to give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. This may seem old school law and gospel, yet we can come to God in full honesty of who we are and how broken we are, and we can trust that God's mercy will prevail. As in the words of Psalm 51, God creates in us a clean heart and puts a new and right spirit within us. However, when we put up the boundaries of our own righteousness and our own superiority, then this new spirit doesn't take hold. Instead, we hold to our own arrogance and our own broken belief that we are privileged, and thank God we are not like those others. That is not what God wants from us. God wants our honesty and the chance to renew in us a right spirit through God's love, a spirit of humility, of service, and above all, of love. Our pride keeps us from that, but our honesty removes the walls that separate us from God and helps us encounter the rich, abundant, life-giving love of God. So may we be honest to God and about ourselves. May we, with open arms, accept God's great mercy. And may we know, as we do, that everyone around us and through this world are just as entitled to that same love and mercy. It is what binds us together as a single family of God. Amen. In Christ, you have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. We believe in him and are marked with the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, and was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Build yourselves up on your most holy faith. Pray in the Holy Spirit. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Look forward to the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Behold, everything has become new. In gratitude and humility, let us join now together in prayer on behalf of all God's creation. God of mercy, you are in the midst of us, and we are called by your name. Inspire your church to serve and love all people with the unceasing grace you extend to us. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of all creation, you formed a world where even the sparrow finds a home. Preserve the beauty and diversity of all creatures with whom we share the earth. Lead us to protect all living things. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of peace, you are an ever-present help in time of trouble. Rescue families and nations torn apart by violence and warfare. We think of places such as Ukraine, Sudan, and all the places that know warfare and have now for a long time. Unite all people toward common goals of reconciliation and peace for every person. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of hope, you stand with the suffering and give strength. Comfort your people filled with fear or anger, anxiety or shame. Bring healing to all who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. We name now all of those we know who are in need of prayer in this moment. People we name now either aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of restoration, you call us to trust in you and not ourselves alone. Make this congregation a community of humility and repentance, ready to encounter you in love and follow in your ways. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. God of eternal life, to you be the glory forever. We give you thanks for James of Jerusalem and all who have fought the good fight, finished the race, kept the faith, and now live with you. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. God and community, holy and one, may we never be apart from you, even as we pray as we are taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, in your great love, you richly provide for our needs. Make of these gifts a banquet of blessing, and make us ready to share with all in need. Through Jesus Christ, who sets a table for all. Amen. We follow Christ, who says, "Take up your cross." We follow Christ, who bids us come and die. We follow Christ, who summons us to new life. The one who calls us is faithful and will keep us.
Salvation belongs to our God and to Christ alone forever and ever.
Receive the blessing. God, who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace. And may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen. I hope that you have all had a good week. In terms of announcements, there's a few ongoing ones. The one to take note of is that the book club has changed dates. We won't start on the 24th of October anymore, but instead on November 7th. I had something come up that conflicted with that date of the 24th, but the November dates allow us to get through the book throughout the month of November and then be finished before Advent really gets rolling. As well, big thank you for our first, to all those who contributed to our first silent auction. The total is listed there, and thank you not only to those who bid on items, but for those who contributed items. That's very helpful, and thank you so much for your effort and your willingness to donate those items to make this work. Of course, the food bank and the hub are asking for some help now as the colder weather starts to loom ever closer. The hub is looking for food, or for clothing rather, for adults specifically. And of course, the Duke Food Bank is always looking for help as the need on that organization seems to continue to grow month by month. And of course, our Operation Christmas Child continues. Our pickup dates, actually doesn't list them here, but know that you can drop off boxes either here at the church or other places, but in the end, all of this is the distribution center, so the boxes end up here. So please, if you are choosing to fill a box this year, you can still do so, and you have time till kind of near to the end of November to get that done. Of course, Denise is also stepping away from her role as the coordinator of this, and that will be effective as of December 31st of this year. So if there's any interest whatsoever in that you may have in taking over that role, just let her know, and her number is listed here in the bulletin. There aren't any birthdays or anniversaries this week, so if we've missed you, we apologize. And we pray that you have a good and wonderful birthday or anniversary this week, and that you have a blessed year ahead. So I do hope that you have a good and wonderful week, a healthy week, and that you will continue to enjoy this rather marvelous fall that we've all been treated to this year, and get out and enjoy it before the weather turns. So bye for now, and again, have a good and safe week ahead.
Joyful and free.
Go in peace with Christ beside you. Thanks be to God.